Good morning. Oh, try again, please. Good morning. Much better. Thank you. Welcome to Sunday worship with Indian Creek Church of the Brethren. Whether you're with us here in person or you're with us online, we are so glad that you are with us and worshiping with us today. Your presence is an encouragement to us, and we hope this time of worshiping together will be an encouragement to you in your own spiritual journey. Please let us know if there's anything we can do to help you in this way. This morning, we're welcoming our brother Dan Gatlin as our guest minister. We will get to see Dan soon, but I'm not going to make him stand up now. That's better that way. But right now, I'd like to invite Sarah to come up and give us an update on the Pastoral Search Committee, please.
Good morning. So my update for you guys today is that our congregational profile is complete. So that was the document that you all filled out, those surveys that we then as a search committee compiled, put all of it into one neat little document that the district, the denomination actually has. And now that is going to be sent off to our district executive, Pete Contra, who's going to upload it to the Magical District database so that pastors can see what our church looks like on paper. So from there, then people, potential candidates can apply. They can see our church. These names will get passed on to the search committee. Search committee will interview. Eventually, a person will be presented to the congregation that you will then vote on. There's a lot of steps in this process, so don't worry too much about the details right now. We will take things as they come. So for right now, you guys won't hear from me until we get people that we are interviewing for potential pastors. So if you have any questions or if what's the update, I might not have an update. That's where we're at right now. The congregational profile is being sent to the district tomorrow morning. And then you will hear from me again once we start interviewing potential people to be our full-term, long-term pastor. And then I'm going to invite Kevin to come up and give an announcement.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So I'm going to try to be modern and read from my little phone here. On behalf of the leadership team, I would like to share some wonderful news with you. Pastor Tim Moyer has accepted our call to be our interim pastor and to serve us here at Indian Creek Church of the Brethren. So Tim's service will begin July 15th. I should be reading. He'll work part-time. He'll work about 22 hours a week. He will preach 3 Sundays a month and be in the office a couple of days a week. We, the leadership team, will meet with him in the next couple of weeks to work out all the other details. In addition to having Pastor Tim available for pastoral visits, spiritual leadership, preaching most Sunday mornings, he will show us how centering ourselves on Jesus will help us to be united in worship and to pull us away from the divisions that we've experienced and that we hear about throughout the denomination and beyond. So, Pastor Tim, his wife Sharon, and their pet Nikki, please give them a warm welcome when you next see them when they come. Thank you.
Had to get back to the regular program. Please join us now as we prepare our hearts for worship and we listen to the prelude. Thank you. Thank you, Sheila. Let's unite in prayer. Father, thank you for this summer, for the warmth of the sun, for the heat that it brings, for the rain, sometimes loud and thunderous at times, but welcome nonetheless. Thank you for all the joys that you give us. Thank you for holding us in your hand through those joys, and thank you for holding us through even the sorrows. We thank you so much for today, for this time to be together, for this time to worship. And we hope that you continue to be with us as we go through not only this day, but all of our days. And as always, we pray to you in our risen Savior's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our call to worship this morning, please read with me in response. I'll wait for the girls to get up here. Sometimes we see God's blessings all around us, and we easily realize how blessed we are.
During those times, it is easy to count it all as joy.
But other times, we face suffering and hard times. Our faith is tested.
Do we even count the hard times as joy?
God will use the hard times to strengthen us and our faith. It is often hard to be patient, but God is faithful.
Knowing that God loves us and has a purpose for us, we can count it all as joy.
All right, please join us now as we worship together in song. We'll be singing "Hear Our Praises" and "Shout to the Lord." And for those gathered here, please stand as you are able.
Okay, so we got requests for more praise songs since we've been doing a lot of hymns lately. So I picked praise songs that we should all know fairly well, and I'm going to be relying on you guys and singing them loud and strong. And we have no drum. We have no bass player. We don't really have a band. We got Sheila, so I'm asking Sheila to play as loud as she can. She's wonderful. But maybe we can add some, you know, coming in with our hands and just kind of give it a little bit more of the rhythm that it needs as we sing together.
Be filled with dancing. May our
familiar, so hopefully we can shout to the Lord. It'll actually be a shout from us. So shout to the Lord. Next.
Excuse me one second. Of course I missed the announcements. It was way back in the beginning. The announcements. You all got these. A couple things to remind you of from here, first of all. This Saturday, July 6th, is the garden brunch at Don and Sue Moyer's home. Remember to carpool if you can. There's a sign-up sheet in the narthex, please. Women's Fellowship is going to be at the Mennonite Resource Center on July 11th from 12:30 to 3. Today is the last day to register for VBS. Tell your friends, tell your neighbors, get a sandwich board, walk around in the streets, find people. Anyway, there's a website there to sign up for. Please, let's do that. Let's make it ring this year. And the Nurture team is organizing a Concert Sundays meetup in the park in Souderton. It's going to be on July 21st. The theme that night is bluegrass music, so that should be an interesting foot-stomping time, I would think. Please sign up for that and meet at 645 near Reliance Road, and please let everybody know so we can look for you as to who's coming. The rest, you know, you can read them. All right, now, you also have this yellow sheet, I hope. Important stuff on this. I only have one update. Please read these. Please take this with you. Read this every day. Pray for these people and these things on this list every day. Let's make it really resonate what the power of prayer can do. The only update I do have is that, as some of you can read, Chris McBreen was admitted to the hospital with a form of anemia. They transferred him from Abington Lansdale down to Abington proper, and they've been giving him blood transfusions, which have made for some really interesting social media updates by him. Apparently, the blood work coming back is looking pretty good, but hopefully he will be out tomorrow and sent home at that point. And Jane's waving her hand back there. Yes. I'm sorry, say it again?
I talked to him last night, and he said he felt a lot better.
Oh, well, that's good. He does feel a lot better. You can tell. I'm telling you, buddy, by his social media posts. You can tell he feels better. All right. One other thing I will tell you before we pray for this list of people that I almost missed. We do have offering plates in the back. Visit them often. And we do have friendship pads in each pew. Please sign in and let us know who was here. That's always helpful. So now, with all that said, let us once again come together in prayer. Father, we bring to you all those people, all those concepts, all those things that we're praying for. We know, Father, that your hand is to comfort and to heal and to guide us in these things. We pray for Chris. We pray for Dottie Miniger's mother. We pray for Nancy Seeker's son-in-law. We pray for Charlene Deacon, for Helen, who's away working in your work in Winston-Salem, North Carolina this summer. And we pray specifically at her request for Chris, for Reese, for a special six-year-old and her parents. We pray for Jeanette. We pray for the Brooklyn First congregation. We pray for the women in our Loss and Longing Mom Support Group. We pray for all the suffering in the world. And we know, Father, that it is your hand that can fix these things. As we come to you like this, Father, we know that you hear us, and we thank you for that. And we bring our prayers to you as often as possible. We pray to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Our scripture focus this morning is from two places. It's from the fifth chapter of 1 Peter, and it's also from the first chapter of James. From 1 Peter, may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. And from James, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. And this being the Sunday for it, if we have any children, we might have children in church, and we have a Donna walking towards me, so I'm going to turn the floor over to her, please, with a microphone in her hand. My goodness.
We are going to invite the youth up to who are on the FaithX trip, and we're going to do a little bit of sharing. We were in, come on up closer to me, I don't bite hard. We were in South Bend, Indiana last week. We stayed at the Prince of Peace Church of the Brethren, and we did several work projects that we'll show you pictures of later. We want to thank everybody for your prayer support, your financial support, your notes of encouragement. Special thanks to our drivers to and from the airport. It was an uneventful week until we landed in Philadelphia. If you watch the news, we were part of that mess. We sat on the tarmac for 2 hours, and then it was just a hot mess. We didn't get home until like 2:30 in the morning, when we should have gotten home before midnight, but everybody was a trooper. We survived, but thank you to Pam and Jane for hanging out for 2 hours at the Wawa waiting for us. So I'm going to ask each of them to share whatever they would like to share, and then we've got some pictures to show that I'll describe what we did.
Okay, so the most memorable experience for me in Indiana was definitely just getting to see the process of us packing food and helping grow stuff in a community garden to actually serving people in need at food bank, soup kitchens and whatnot. And I think that just being able to see the process was really eye-opening for me. And then also our last day, our rec day, when we went to Lake Michigan, that was just a blast, getting to hang out with everybody you become friends with throughout the week and just having a great time.
I enjoyed working at the soup kitchen, where we were serving unhoused people or anybody who needed it food. And it was just really interesting to just see how grateful so many of them were and how optimistic they were despite being in their position.
I enjoyed working in the food bank, just sorting the food and, you know, like finding the expired stuff to throw away. We're organizing it in general, and also working at the soup kitchen.
My favorite part is working at the soup kitchen and helping all those people out who are in the tough times in need and really need food to survive out on the streets.
If you guys want to have a seat so you can see the pictures, that's nice. I did, and it didn't work at first. All right, so I'm going to stand to the side so I can see the pictures. Go ahead, Dennis, whenever you're ready. The theme was Beloved for the FaithX trips this year. This is us, bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, as we were leaving. And we had arrived in South Bend. So our first project, we split in half the first morning, and half of us went to the soup kitchen, and the other half stayed at the church and did some yard work. And I heard from the guys, they really enjoyed power tools and cutting down branches, but I have no pictures of that because I wasn't there. So here's Cadlin. Our first job was cleaning chairs, which we were not expecting to do, but we did it. And then we had a contest who could get the dirtiest rag. And then we actually did the food prep, which was a lot of fun. It was chili day, so Cadlin got to help make chili and serve that. And then that afternoon, we served in the community garden, the Unity Garden, which was really neat. Anybody can come and harvest as much as they want. There's no regulations. The caveat was it was 100 degrees every day that we were there. But they were troopers. Our first job was to squish bugs off of the leaves of the plants. And we explained that we're a peace church, and we oughtn't be killing the first day that we were there. But it was fine. Look how happy they all are. Joseph, I had him stand by. This was a blast from the past for me. Mom will understand. There was mulberry trees there, and that was from my granny's house. She used to have one, and so I spent a lot of my time picking and eating mulberries that day. A lot of weeding. This is our mascot, Peep, who always joins our trips, and Peep was overseeing the weeders. Jaden hard at work. Lots of weeds. Still more weeds. Then Cadlin enjoyed, you didn't mention this, Cadlin, she enjoyed feeding the goat. We dumped all our weeds across the fence to the goat that they own, and he takes care of the weeds. Cadlin also enjoyed chasing the chickens. Joseph liked to get his hands dirty. And then this was our whole group posing at the community gardens, or the Unity Garden sign. Then you heard the kids talk about the food bank. We went to a local food bank, and we had a couple different jobs there. Our main job was sorting food that had been donated into categories. Joseph was super excited, apparently. And then Jaden and some others, I think it was Jaden, Joseph, and Dennis, and some other kids were packing donations into boxes to give to people. We couldn't believe the good stuff that was donated. This is the crew that packed the boxes. They had to fill, how many pallets was it? Four pallets of boxes. Jaden's wrapping it. Cadlin, again, can't believe her good fortune, but we didn't keep it. Jaden got to help out with the grocery duty. People would drive up to the food bank with an order, and then they walked around with a shopping cart filling the order. You had to hustle, didn't you, Jaden? Now, Claire got quite the reputation. Claire here is arguing with Peep about expiration dates. Claire became the boss, because if you don't know, expiration dates, things don't mysteriously expire the day of the expiration date. Everything has a little bit past that it can go, but everything's different. And Claire was the mastermind who had memorized that list. So everybody would be like, Claire, what's the date on soup? And she would say, is it tomato-based? Yes, then a year and a half. You just knew all of it, didn't you, Claire? 4 years if it's not tomato-based, a year and a half if it is. They still know all the dates, so Claire was the person to talk to. And this is our whole group at the food bank. We do devotions every morning and every evening, and I just wanted to show, I divided the kids into groups, not of mixing them up, not from their church group, but for this activity we did our church groups and we did foot washing. And then I think it was the Armadillos, their devotion group, made us all do skits for devotions one night, and everybody really got into it. And then we got to go to a baseball game. That was fun. And this was, Jaden talked about our rec day at Lake Michigan. That was a lot of fun. They built a big sandcastle. And then we were asked to share and worship on Sunday morning there as well. So each of them, again, said like highlights of the week for them. You'll have to ask Claire the story of the French fries. What's that? If they want to know the story, they can ask you. Okay. And then this is us leaving. We didn't know the journey we had ahead of us, but we forgot we hadn't gotten a group picture the whole time we were there, so we got it in the South Bend Airport. So thank you again for your support. The youth did a great job. Like I said, it was 100 degrees outside, and with only a few popsicle breaks here and there, they were real troopers. So thank you again.
I should have printed this bigger. All right. We're going to respond in song one more time. Please join as our group comes forward, and we're singing this time, "You Are God Alone," after which Brother Dan will bring us his message.
Well, good morning, Indian Creek Church of the Brethren. Greetings. I bring you greetings from Monco Bible Fellowship. Amen. Very familiar faces, my brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus. I just wanted to say I'm humbled and honored to be before you to bring a message that I pray that we will glean and gather from. Amen? I just want to just also comment that it was touching my heart so deeply to see the reaffirmation and confirmation of this wonderful program put together in our worship service that's so ideal within this message. That's no one but God. God does that. Amen? But to see the youth, we call them harvest helpers. Remember the word of God says the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. But it really touched and blessed my heart to see the youth going out there and blessing some others who are in need of things that we have. Amen? No matter what we have, there's someone who still does not. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you, God, and we just ask you, God, to open up our ears, open up our hearts, and open up our minds to be recipients of your word today. And God, just use me as another messenger of your word. Speak to my heart, God. Just bring forth a newness on this brand new day you have blessed us with. In Jesus' wondrous, matchless name we pray. Amen. It's just amazing how God coordinates things in this life we live for those who have the faith that God has given us. How many of us know that it is by grace through faith that we are saved? Amen? And this faith, we often forget that it's a gift channeled by God to us. Amen? And I pray also that our faith will abound even more as we move forward in our journey together as believers in Christ. Title of this sermon this morning is Your Breakthrough is Coming. Before I read the text which Chuck had given to us earlier, let's look at the meanings of the expression of the word breakthrough. Well, for one, Kevin, it's a military movement of the expression that says it's an advance all the way through and beyond an enemy's frontline defense. Another expression of this word breakthrough is an act of instance of removing or surpassing an obstruction or a restriction. It's the overcoming of a stalemate. And another definition, if you will, or expression is any significant or sudden advance, development, achievement, or increase, as in scientific knowledge or diplomacy, that removes a barrier to move forward and be progressive. Now, for the believer, a breakthrough often requires, sometimes unfortunately, but how can your faith be tested without trials? Amen? A breakthrough often requires a trial to break through. It would be nice to simply wake up one day and suddenly become this very mature Christian. But in order to grow up in God, we will have to grow through and go through trials. Amen? There is no other way to grow strong spiritually than to go through some trials. Anybody here? Anybody listening? I know it's not a Verizon commercial, but can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Let's go back to 1 Peter 5:10. And I'll be reading out of the New King James Version. And it says, "But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you." You might not like trials. I know I don't. Amen? They appear when we least expect them. But listen, this verse says that when you're going through trials, after you have suffered for a little while, you will grow to be firmly rooted and grounded, strong, firm, and steadfast, even the more in God. Amen? One of the great things God has built in every bit of his creation is resiliency. We all bounce back, amen? In our time, in God's appointed time, and trusting God, we bounce back.
Listen, this is beautiful because let me dissect that text for a minute. God promises to perfect you. Like a doctor that sets a broken bone, God will mend our broken lives and make us whole again. All the letters of Peter is listen, if you can umbrella these two words, hope again, the entire writings of Peter is expressing that there's always hope again. No matter what you go through in life, no matter what you're going through in life, we can't still light a candle next to Jesus for what he went through for us. Is there a witness in the building? This is awesome. God promises to establish you. God will make our way stable despite the instability we may feel living in a world that attempts to inflict suffering upon us. God says he will strengthen you. God will give us the ability to succeed in all that we do for him. And he says, settle you. I think of when sometimes the situations happen in our lives, there's this settlement like dust. You ever ride on a dirt road or you just go on a shoulder of the road on a hot day and this dust just appears just from the little bit of wind that you create by your vehicle. But all of a sudden, in less than 20 seconds, that dust settles. Amen? It's kind of like that in your spirit. It's like, I feel settled. I'm okay now. I'm strengthened. Amen? I can get through this. God has healed that wound. A lot of us, listen, these wounds do make you stronger. Because I see him, God will stop the bleeding. We all have some internal bleeding wounds, amen? But if you allow God, listen, remember this, Jesus isn't just a healer. Maybe to other world religions, but to us, the believer, Jesus is our healer, amen? Wow, if there's any mice in here, we can hear them. Amen. That's good. That's a good sign. Listen, as a consequence of this settling you, are facing the attacks of the enemy or people that we call our naysayers, God will build in us a firm foundation that will make us steadfast and immovable. Similarly, in James 1:12 says, blessed is the man who endures temptation. For when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. The believer who endures trials demonstrates his or her love for Jesus and therefore will receive the crown of life. What size crown do you wear? Or will you wear? Amen. Here again, you don't get the rewards of the crown of life until you have persevered under trials and stood the test. Every man or woman in this life is in a state of temptation or trials. And in this state, he or she is a candidate for another and a better world. He or she that stands in his or her trial shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to them that love him. I can't speak to anyone in here this morning, but I'm in love with Jesus. Amen. There's a song we used to sing. I used to sing the lead in it. I was nervous singing the first lead song ever. Because I said I liked to sing until God had another thing he had to get my attention. But it was a song called Can't Help Myself. And just a couple of verses, it says, when I think about the love of Jesus, I can't help myself. What he's done, it's just amazing for what he's done. I was walking along this sinful road. I met King Jesus who made me whole. He touched my, filled my heart with love. He wrote my name above. When I think about the love of Jesus, I can't help myself. I know Natasha's saying, well, why don't you just sing it, Dan? No, I'm just kidding. Listen, it's the only love to God that can enable a man and a woman to endure the trials of life. Love feels no burdens or heavy loads. All practical things are possible to him or her who loves. So let us learn to be thankful even in your trials, because in order to get your breakthrough, you need a trial to break through. Therefore, don't be discouraged during your times of suffering. Know that after you have suffered for a little while, God himself will make you strong, firm, and steadfast. In order to help you get your breakthrough, we also need to understand that it may also require how we look at the trials we encounter. By learning to take a long-term look at your short-term problems. And I love this because you had it in your program. The scripture said, weeping sometimes may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Amen? The blessings of a brand new day. Instead of saying, ho-hum, I'm still stuck in this little period or moment in my life. But God, I know you brought me joy because you decided to keep me on the green side of the grass. Amen? When people ask me, how am I doing? I say, you got a minute? I'm not going to just say okay or all right, because God made us half left. I'm working on the all right. But I say to them, you know what? I'm blessed to be on the green side of the grass, and I'm not on the brown side. Right? We got that. Because after all, trials and troubles don't last always. That's what that scripture means. You know, how many of us, I'm not asking for hands, but there's many a times before I lay to rest, I'll pray and I'll find tears flooding out of me because I'm praying for someone in need, praying for someone's healing, amen, praying for someone to get through and know the promises says, if you seek me, I will hear you. God hears every prayer, every heartfelt prayer. He will. He's already got it checked up for you. And guess what? The things that blow our minds is when it comes to pass. That person's out of the hospital. That person's no longer sick. Amen? That person doesn't have that problem. Amen? But they're still here with us, our family members. Amen? Listen, whenever something frustrating happens, don't immediately become upset. Instead, ask yourself, is this problem really worth getting aggravated over? You know, is this a 5-minute problem, a 5-hour problem? Is it a 5-month problem or a 5-year problem? If you can't say amen, say oh my. For example, if you can't find where around your house you left your car keys. Anybody ever have that? Or your sunglasses? Where's my sunglasses? It's right on top of your head. Don't let that steal your love and your joy and your peace and your patience. Amen? Don't let that dig into the wonderful fruit bowl or basket that God promises us to have. Amen? Being 5 minutes late to most things is not worth losing your joy over. Similarly, if you're stuck in traffic, everybody, come on somebody. This is where that patient produces character and character produces hope. We almost forget whose we are in Christ. Amen? Especially, I love, this is my favorite, when someone passes by you and you meet them at the red light. Are you thinking about, oh, well, I'm so glad you met me here, or what were you trying to do? You wasted 25 cents on your gas. How far did it get you? Amen? If you're stuck in a traffic jam, don't let that ruin your fruit of the Spirit. It's not worth getting upset about and uptight about a 10-minute delay on your way to work, for those who do work. God bless you. My wife and I are officially retired. Somebody say glory, hallelujah. But not from Jesus, not from the work of the Lord. Amen. I don't believe we ever retire for that. Indeed, 10 minutes is nothing compared to all eternity. Also, remember that God may be using your short-term problems or issues for a long-term purpose. That's why James 1, we can turn to that, verses 2 and 5 states, James chapter 1, 2, and 5 says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. And if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all freely, liberally, and without reproach, and it will be given to him. Trials are, listen, are of outward circumstances, conflicts, sufferings, and troubles encountered by all believers. Trials are not pleasant and may be extremely grievous, but believers are to consider them as opportunities for rejoicing. Am I crazy? There are some things you reflexively and humanly are going to act upon. Amen? Listen, we don't always think of what we're asked to do by God immediately. That always doesn't happen, does it? When you hear someone that has cancer, you know, when you hear someone in your family closest to you, you just can't believe it. Amen? But God is saying, listen, can you make it an opportunity to just say, Lord, I'm going to rejoice in you. Listen, we say this one thing. If you can't say amen, say hallelujah anyhow. Troubles and difficulties are a tool which refines and purifies our faith, producing patience and endurance. The word translated testing of your faith occurs also in 1 Peter 1:7. That the genuineness, of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. It's like gold, if you want it in its purest form, has to get heated up. Then the dross, they wipe that. It's like a green color that comes through the gold to purify it. And they simply wipe it away. God says, I want you to just seek me. Continue seeking me on this journey while we are still here. The term, which means tested or approved, was used for coins that were genuine and not debased. The aim of testing is not to destroy or afflict, but to purge and refine. It is, listen, essential to Christian maturity. And you remember the story in Abraham's faith that had to be tested in Genesis chapter 2. A little homework for you. We know that story. Talking about a sacrifice directly asked of God to Abraham of his very own son. Awesome story. The meaning of patience transcends the idea of bearing affliction with the help of Jesus. It includes the idea of standing fast under pressure with a staying power that turns adversities into opportunities. Verse 4 in the text of James chapter 1. If a believer endures a trial, he or she will be perfect, meaning having reached the end and completeness, meaning whole. Finding the wholeness, amen? The wisdom God gives is not necessarily, in verse 5, information on how to get out of trouble, but rather insight on how to learn from one's difficulties. It is not more information about how to avoid times of testing, but instead a new perspective on handling trials. The wisdom of God begins with genuine reverence for the Almighty God. Psalm 111:10. The fear, the reverence of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all those who do his commandments. His praise endures forever. And having steadfast confidence that God controls all circumstances, guiding them to his good purposes. And if you ever just do a study, we had it one years ago, just took one scripture, Romans 8:28, and we had about five or six people in our Monday night Bible class years ago, and we asked everyone to pray and give their expression of what that meant. And you would be surprised what we discussed and the commonality of what that was. But he says, how can issues and trials and suffering become a benefit to our goodness in the Lord? Because you know God is in control. When you find that God is really in control of all things, he can do what he desires to do. Amen? It's his will. He allows things to occur. He permits things to happen. Amen? But we are always being tried and we are always being tested. And I just pray that through your current trials and any difficulties, in order to produce lasting benefits such as your faith, amen, and your perseverance and of your spiritual maturity, as I close, that's why it's so important to take a long-term look at your short-term problems and get your breakthrough today. Indian Creek, your breakthrough's coming. God already has the person that he has appointed to be continuously here, that person that's going to help you, amen, that person that's going to be a good person who loves Jesus, who's going to help grow together. But we have to get to know each other to grow together. Amen? That's everywhere you go, everywhere you are. And I just pray that Indian Creek, we pray for you guys, and we're hoping that you guys are praying for Monco Bible Fellowship. My wife and I were talking to Natasha this morning as they was rehearsing, that we're excited, that can't wait to get back on board with the choir. Amen? We'll have more availability to help out where we can. But I just thank you for this time. I'm very humbled. Let us have our benediction. Amen. Do we stand? One more song. I see that. I made a little note, but it's okay. But okay. All right. Sure. Oh, Days of Elijah. How can I forget?
Okay, yes, let's stand. We're going to sing our closing song, Days of Elijah. And just in reflecting on the sermon and having a long-term vision for our short-term, you know, issues that we're dealing with, Days of Elijah talks about, though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. And so we're preparing God's return. And we're all looking forward to Christ's second coming, when all of our tears are going to be wiped away, all of our problems are going to be gone, and we're just going to be praising God as he comes. So that's what we're going to do with this song, as we envision beholding him coming, rising on a cloud, shining like the sun, and everything else it says. So let's sing and remember that. All right. We have to be our drummer.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. Though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness.
I was just going to say, anyone who can stand, please. Out of the thousands of promises of God, I want to simply say, now to him who by the power at work within us is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or even think. To him, to God, be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever until you return. In your precious name we pray these things. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen.